Aloha everyone, and welcome to Deep Conversations with Hyrum. This is something new for my channel that I'm really excited about. I'm just really eager to talk about, you know, deeper issues, social issues, things that are really relevant to us and the way that we lead our lives, and just to have a conversation with you guys about things that I think are really important. Not that skincare isn't important, but I've really been wanting to explore a bunch of different topics besides skincare on my channel, just, you know, to open the conversation. Discuss things that I think are really interesting from a social, philosophical, anthropological, perspective. And for this video, I want to talk about the true cost of being a content creator. Cue the sad pity violin as I talk about how my life is so much harder than everyone else's. No, bitch, that's not what this is about. I'm not coming on here to complain about how my life and the life of other content creators is so damn difficult because, bitch, it's not. I stand by this. Content creators have some of the best jobs on the planet, and I personally think that I have the best job I could ever dream of. I get to do what I love. I have you guys, an incredibly loving and supportive community, and so many of my dreams have come true. But over time, I have been able to see both sides of being a viewer of social media content and being a content creator, and it's opened my eyes in a lot of ways to some issues that a lot of people don't tend to talk about when it comes to being a personality online. It is well known that being the job of a content creator is one of the most desired jobs in the world. In a recent poll among Generation Z asking what their most desired job would be, YouTube creator was at the number one spot. Number one, which I think is amazing because I absolutely love my job. But I do think we tend to overlook some of the potential side effects of creating content, documenting your life, and posting it online for the world to see, and how it impacts the individual's physical health, mental health, and social health. And I don't blame Gen Z. Are you kidding me? Look at any social media content out there. Life looks so much fun. People are living the dream. They just get to play all day long and then post videos about it. It can't be that difficult, right? Well, yes. And also no. Two things can be true at once, mijo. As amazing as the lives of content creators can seem, and I know that may be present even for my viewers who watch my videos, there are some sacrifices that need to be made that I haven't talked about on my channel and I really want to discuss in today's video. Now, I know I said this before, but just to reiterate, this is not saying that being a content creator is an awful job, that I or other content creators hate our jobs, because that is absolutely not true. Well, I can't speak for other people, but I can speak for myself. That's not true. However, I have noticed some interesting social effects that not only paint an interesting dual-sided picture as to what content creators struggle with behind the scenes, but I do think there's an interesting paradox that should be spoken to with what happens behind the screens and how this actually impacts the viewer. If you are on this channel, you know this, we all consume so much social media content. And while I am a firm believer that social media can edify our lives in so many different ways, I do think we need to be aware of what's happening, both on screen, behind the screen, and to us personally. And if consuming social media content is even natural or good for our brains. Yes, you heard it right here, a social media content creator questioning whether or not social media is good for you. Am I putting myself out of a job? We shall see. One of the most commonly occurring dynamics when it comes to creating content online is facing the overwhelming amount of criticism and negativity from millions of people. The infamous hate comments. Now, I know what you're thinking because I thought this exact same thing too. Oh, boohoo, you get to make money doing what you love and face some criticism from a few people. Big deal. Big whoop, bro. Get over it, you have an amazing job. And let me tell you, I had this perspective when I first started creating content online. I didn't know it then, but I adopted an almost emotionally numb perspective towards my audience. I didn't want to risk being hurt by the negativity I saw online, so I refused to define myself or validate myself from the positivity I saw online. Don't validate the positive, don't validate the negative. And this wasn't to say that I would write off any positive comment that came my way. I actually really genuinely appreciated having positivity in my comment sections and seeing how much people were enjoying my videos. But slowly I began to realize that it wasn't sustainable to keep this perspective. If I wanted to have a genuine, authentic connection with my audience online, I needed to allow myself to be emotionally vulnerable and be welcoming to the positivity that they gave me. And inadvertently, also be vulnerable to the negativity. And rather than forcing myself to be emotionally numb and not let positive comments actually, you know, make me happy, I decided to be vulnerable with my audience, and that is honestly something I am eternally grateful for. The amount of joy and happiness that I've received from my subscribers is honestly unprecedented, and I'm so proud to be able to have a community of love and support constantly around me. It's literally the best thing in the world. But of course, that also meant the negativity would sting. Now, let me just say, as someone who has faced a lot of personal rejection in my life, I mean, hell, my parents disowned me for being gay. I remember thinking to myself, there is no way I will let a negative comment get to me because it can't even compare to the life experiences that I've had so far. When you're constantly faced with negativity online, it's only going to be a matter of time before you break. And that was something I was so ashamed to admit, because if there was one thing I was not gonna let tear me down, it's a faceless anonymous user spewing hate with no accountability. But in reality, it's only natural and human for us to be somewhat affected by negativity at some point. I didn't realize how much of a negative impact hate comments and hate messages could have on me right up until I launched my brand. This really isn't something that I've shared with most people, but for the first week of my brand reveal right up until my brand launch, I was in a pretty serious state of depression. I saw more hate comments and more hate messages than I had ever seen in my entire career online. When I had spent so many sleepless nights, time, blood, sweat, and energy, all going towards something so special to me, my own brand, it really hurt when I saw some people negatively respond. And I will say, I had an incredible brand launch. It has been so amazing and better than I ever could have imagined. But it is sad to look back and realize that for that time that I should have been the most happy, the most excited, revealing my brand to the world, I was in a serious state of depression because of the anonymous opinions of millions of people online. Because those comments really knew how to hit home. They weren't criticizing my content, they weren't criticizing my looks, they were criticizing my character. The unfortunate reality I had to learn is that when you get a lot of online attention, you're gonna get a lot of negativity with it. And this was something I had experienced multiple times in the past. I mean, me and other content creators all face so many hate comments. It's a normal part of the job. But I've noticed that every content creator can only handle so much negativity online before, at some point, it breaks them. After our characters are criticized countless times, we're forced to face the confusion of finding a new self-identity. And this is where you see a lot of content creators tend to go two different paths. Either absorbing the negativity to the point that mental health seriously struggles, content is no longer created, or develop a new self-identity that's forcibly ignorant to any criticism faced online, and all vulnerability or accountability is gone. And thankfully, I am doing a lot better since then, but it really brought up the question to me, is it fundamentally natural for humans to be able to perceive and process the opinions of millions of people? The appeal of social media content creators is their accessibility, their connection to their audience, and the ultra transparency about so many aspects of their life. Opposed to celebrities who are typically more so represented as a brand, separate from who they are personally, creators tend to share a lot more about the intimate details of their life. And this isn't necessarily a bad thing. I personally think that there's a lot of amazing elements to this. Social media has really redefined authenticity and made people feel understood, but as a content creator, because of that personal connection, it does open up every aspect of your life to constant criticism. And that can really hurt a lot because people aren't insulting a persona or a brand, they're insulting who you are fundamentally. One example that comes to mind is the YouTuber Samantha Ravendahl. She was to be wed to her spouse, of course a joyous occasion, but was very hesitant about sharing those details online because of the potential criticism she could see. And sure enough, when she started posting pictures of the most special day of her life, her wedding, online, due to the unfortunately common hate comments that roll in, it made her resent her wedding pictures and even her wedding day. The day that was most special to her was tainted by the negativity and hatred she saw online. And this is such an interesting dynamic to me because we live in an unprecedented time. Never before have we been able to share information to millions of people around the world and be able to process the opinions and feedback of so many people all at once. And in line with facing that question of whether or not this is fundamentally natural for humans to be able to process all of this information, my mind started to think about neo-tribalism. Neo-tribalism is the ideology that human beings have evolved to live in a tribal as opposed to a modern society and thus cannot achieve genuine happiness until some semblance of tribal lifestyles has been recreated or re-embraced. I personally have thought at length about modernity and this hyper-connectivity that we have with so many people around the world, and whether or not it is a good thing or a bad thing. Think about it. We as humans are tribal creatures. Human tribes have existed for well over 2 million years, so it's really not far off to assume that we're still heavily tied to our tribal roots of connection. Being that we as humans are social creatures, and personally as an introvert, I do think that's unfortunate. Either a lack of connection or too much connection could potentially be problematic to our mental health. Now, there are radical interpretations of neo-tribalism, many of which I heavily disagree with because they're really rooted in misogyny and racism, but I think identifying our tribal history speaks to a reality and problem a lot of us ignore. Considering that this modern day hyperconnectivity that we have through social media is really only, like, what, 25 years old? Even considering the thousands of years that we've had modern civilization, it's still not taking into account the millions of years that humans have been tribal creatures. And when you think of a tribe, what do you think of? Probably a very small group of people, at most a few families, living together. Definitely not the massive civilizations that we've seen in modern society. Neo-tribalism aligns with this belief, that certain aspects of industrial and post-industrial life, including the necessity of living in a society of strangers and interacting with organizations that have memberships far above Dunbar's number, are cited as inherently detrimental to the human mind as it has evolved. Now, first off, what the hell is a Dunbar's number? Dunbar's number is the theory that the maximum amount of people that we can have within our social circles before it becomes detrimental is right at about 150 people. When you consider our long tribal history as humans, 150 people is a pretty big number. Definitely not every tribe was that big. Compare that to nowadays, it's pretty normal for people to have a combined over 1,000 friends on social media. And that's definitely not including the amount of people that you've met, had discussions with, seen in passing, or just met once. It's a pretty stark contrast. Of course, evolution would lead us to adjust to the environment that we live in over time, and I'm no scientist, but doesn't that take quite a long time? Evolution is a very slow process, and I don't think it's had time to catch up with the modern day experience of social media and being connected to millions of people around the world. 25 years? I mean, come on, evolution, catch up. I find these theories really fascinating because it brings into question just how normal it is for us to be so connected in the modern era, and exploring the potential of whether or not this can have a negative or positive impact on our health. Is it normal for us to maintain relationships with thousands of people, many of which we don't see in a day-to-day capacity, to have a parasocial relationship with the creators that we watch, and of course, as a content creator, being able to process the opinions of thousands upon thousands of people online, spewing negativity towards us? I'm just geeking out and theorizing, people. So the question remains, is it detrimental to our health to be able to be connected to so many people at once, let alone process the opinions and feedback of millions of people? I know for myself, I don't think it's normal, and it's something that I'm navigating every day, and I think there's so many positive benefits to being connected to so many people, but it is in moments where I do see a lot of hate comments or negativity online that I have to remind myself that this entire experience is probably not fundamentally normal or natural to human beings. So I need to give myself a break. Another dynamic I've noticed in my personal journey of creating content online is that, and let me explain before you judge, social media can sometimes be the literal definition of gaslighting. I know, you're rolling your eyes at this term, gaslight gatekeep girl boss. I swear to God, TikTok has made me hate the word gaslight. We know this, the term has become so diluted through social media, but let's break down the definition. Gaslighting is the act of manipulating a person by forcing them to question their thoughts, memories, and the events occurring around them. A victim of gaslighting can be pushed so far that they question their own sanity. Now, I know it's a bold assumption to assume that social media can be gaslighting, but let me explain with a personal example. When I was launching my brand and reading a lot of the negative comments and messages that I saw every single minute, I saw countless people saying that I wasn't involved in the creation of the products, that it was all just a PR stunt, and here's the thing, I knew all of those things were not true. I knew that I spent countless all-nighters working on this brand and the products, that I was in the lab with the chemist developing them. That the number one reason I wanted to create my brand was to generate social change, to provide people with clean drinking water, and to protect forests from deforestation. That was the most important thing to me. And that the last thing I wanted this brand to be was just a PR stunt. A feel-good story. But when I read hundreds and thousands of these comments accusing me of these things, it made me start to question my own reality. I started to question whether or not I actually was in the lab with the chemists developing these products, whether or not I had spent all these countless sleepless nights working on the brand, whether I actually cared about helping the world. Things that I knew were fundamentally true to my character, I all of a sudden was questioning solely because I was seeing these accusations occur hundreds and thousands of times. I started to hate myself because I felt like I wasn't doing enough, even though I had pushed my own physical health to its absolute limit by not getting enough sleep and working too hard, by pulling 3 to 4 all-nighters a week and having absolutely no social life. I started to feel inadequate and question whether or not I had actually started this brand to make a positive difference in the world, which is unreal because I know myself, I know I started all of this, I know I did all of these things. It wasn't humanly possible for me to be more involved in the creation of my brand, yet people gaslighted me into believing I wasn't good enough and that my intent wasn't pure. And it makes me really sad to think about because I know I'm not the only one who is going through this experience. I know that other content creators are going through the same experience. I have watched so many of the sweetest, genuinely good people online receive some of the most vicious hate I have ever seen for no reason and gaslight these people into believing that they are a bad person. And it took me a while for me to wake up and realize that these people don't know me. They don't know what I had to do to make this possible. They don't know the reality, so they can't speak to what the reality is when they weren't even present. The malicious intent initiated through making a spiteful comment or a hateful message isn't created out of a genuine desire to understand the reality, but rather to ensure the reality is morphed into the person's perception of assuming the worst. And that's the challenging thing when it comes to creating content online. You may know your intent, the reason you do what you do, and your actions, but the perception of reality solely matters. And thousands of people constantly push you into believing a false narrative that can be really, really harmful to your mental health. I could talk and theorize all day about why this is, but honestly, if you want a good breakdown of it, I recommend watching ContraPoint's video talking about pseudo-moralism and pseudo-intellectualism. She breaks down those concepts in a genius way, and I highly recommend watching her video Canceling, because I think it really reveals a lot of the reasons as to why people feel the need to interact with content creators in this way. Another dynamic I've noticed that's present within myself and so many other content creators that I find fascinating is loneliness. This really isn't spoken about because it seems to be the opposite of reality, but there's a present paradox that where the attention increases, loneliness also increases as well. I noticed within myself that as I started to get a lot more attention online, I started to feel more lonely, and I was so confused as to why that is, because it seems like you have so many friends, you have so many people out there who support you and love you and want the best for you, and you have what so many people spend their entire lives trying to get, but it just doesn't feel great. My eyes were really opened to this problem when I started seeing a lot of content creators' private stories or private TikTok posts. Mind you, some of these content creators being some of the biggest on each of these platforms, I really had a paradigm shift seeing how many creators post about how lonely they are, feeling extremely isolated, sadness, and even depression due to their presence online. And I think there's two primary reasons for this. First, while it may seem that content creators are the epitome of social beings, in reality, we spend the majority of our time by ourselves at our computers, no social interaction, constantly working. I know it doesn't seem like that, it doesn't look like that, but that really is the reality. 90% of my time is spent alone in my office, working all hours of the day and night, editing content, posting content, filming content, you know the deal. Unfortunately, we don't really get to clock out of work. Work is constant.
All day, all night, all day, all night.
I love that TikTok audio. There's really no time for friendships or relaxation time. And unfortunately, if there are friendships, a lot of times, they're usually documented in a way that's exploited for content. I noticed this personally when I really started to blow up on YouTube and TikTok. I realized that from the second I woke up until the second I went to bed, I was constantly working on creating content. All of my friendships were fractured or broken because I wasn't spending time with anyone, nor was I texting anyone back, or just interacting with people, period. There was absolutely no social interaction. Yet online, I was seeing so much success, so much interaction from so many people, yet I didn't have any real qualitative friendships in my own life. Or I did at one point, but they were now broken because all of my time was spent on social media. But the other reason I believe loneliness is so commonplace is because interactions with people started to feel more like an objectifying experience rather than a meaningful connection. And this goes hand in hand with the loss of privacy. Stay with me, I promise I'll get to the point. One of the most incredible things about having a community online is that genuine connection you feel when commenting back and forth, messaging people. But I started to notice that this really morphed in my day-to-day life. When I get to meet people who have watched my content in real life, it is an incredible experience. I absolutely love it. It's literally my favorite thing in the world. But it is different from an organic connection that you would establish based off of two people not knowing each other, meeting and developing a relationship. AKA, meeting someone who's watched a lot of my videos, knows who I am, knows details about my life, while I don't know anything about who they are or what their life is like. It is so amazing and literally the best feeling in the world to be able to meet you guys in public every single day whenever I'm shopping or going out to eat. But I also started to notice that the experience of meeting people who have engaged with my content in real life has started to make me feel more lonely. Truthfully, I am no one. However, I do meet a good amount of people every single day who come up to me and say that they love watching my videos and have engaged with my content, and I get to meet them and interact with them, take pictures, all that stuff. While really exciting when being able to meet people who've watched my videos in real life has led to some pretty serious loss of privacy that has personally impacted me in some really negative ways. I think because of the parasocial relationship that is established online through social media, it allows some people to think that they have more access to you than other people. There was a time where my personal address and phone number was leaked. I was having random people calling and texting my phone, texting me information about myself that was private. My address where I live and where I used to work was leaked. I had people who could see in my windows and were describing in detail in my comment sections and messages what I was doing every day and night. And it was pretty traumatizing to me, to the point that I actually moved locations for my own personal security and safety, and then ended up completely moving to a different area with more security and to make sure that that doesn't happen again. It really does just make me not feel great. And this is obviously an extreme example that I do not wish upon my worst enemy, but that lack of privacy and creeping loneliness starts to impact every single element of your life. I catch people all the time taking pictures or videos of me without me knowing, where I'll just be doing something super normal, like standing at a stoplight when I realize the person next to me has been videoing me the entire time without my knowledge or consent, and now I have to worry about how I look, what they're gonna use that for, if they're doing it with malicious intent, who they are, what their intent is. It creates a lot of anxiety. And this is a totally different situation to when someone comes up to you and asks you for a picture, because consent is involved. I'm able to give my consent, I know what's going on, everything's good. But when there's a lack of consent, there's a lack of privacy. And that lack of privacy can seriously affect your mental health in a negative way. And this really does affect every single moment of your life. And I understand this sounds like the most privileged problem, and it really is. It's a wonderful opportunity to be in this position, I totally understand that. But I think as humans, in order to be in a healthy mental state, privacy is something that is inherent to all of us. You can't be on 24/7, never able to fully experience a moment because you're thinking about if people are going to be courting you without your consent, coming up to you, thinking about how you look, your personal safety, all these different things. It's just, it's not natural. Also, side note, if you see me in public, please come up and say hi to me. I love meeting people. I would love to take a picture with you. It's my favorite thing. I promise this is not me discouraging you from doing that. I want to meet you in person. Another issue I see that's present online, not only with content creators, but also just with anyone who engages with social media in general, is comparing ourselves. We all know this, so I won't speak to it much, but it is natural for humans to compare ourselves to others, and this experience is hyper-exaggerated by using social media. There have been so many studies done, and there's so much data out there showing the link between a negative self-perception and increased use of social media. And most of the time, we'll inevitably feel inadequate. This is really present with content creators specifically because we have to consume a lot of content online. In order to be aligned with the trends, be in touch with the community, and just know what's going on, we have to see what a lot of other people are doing. And depending on who you follow, social media can really breed a lot of insecurities, particularly within the beauty space, which I am a part of. It's natural for us to compare ourselves to these unrealistic beauty standards. And I think viewers also experience the same exact thing. We compare ourselves to what we see online and hyperfixate on the negative aspects of who we are or our limited abilities and define ourselves by them. I think it's important to realize that comparisons are natural, it's in our DNA, it's what we do as humans, and it's important to find validation through other sources. Learning, the arts, nature, self-development, passions, interests, hobbies, those are all more substantial than comparing yourself to what you see online. Hi guys. So it's been a month since I filmed the other parts of this video. It's been quite a while. I just finished a month of work travel and I am battle-torn, beaten, and bruised. I just want to say real quick, I apologize for being gone for a month. I know it's a long time, especially considering how frequently I used to post, but I just really needed it, and I know you guys will be understanding, so thank you for understanding. But there is another thing I want to talk about that I honestly think is really relevant to this topic and has been impacting me and a lot of other creators, and also viewers, over the past month. For the very few people who watch every single one of my videos, you guys may have noticed that I really haven't posted a YouTube video in the last month. I took the break because in addition to feeling pretty overwhelmed because of work and adding in work travel on top of that, which is always just craziness and insanity, and I just don't have time for anything. I also took the break because of mental health, and not to worry, my mental health is actually pretty good. I'd say it's in a good place over the past few months. But I did start to notice an experience happening with me that I also see is happening with a lot of other content creators online right now. And that experience is specifically the pressure of constant improvement. I really wasn't sure if I was going to talk about this in this video, but given the current state of social media, I think it's actually pretty important. Over the past month, I've personally taken a break off of YouTube to just really refocus on myself and my mental health and just get some mental clarity away from the constant pressure of always having to create and post content. If you guys know my channel from last year, you know that I was posting 5 times, sometimes 6 times a week on YouTube, in addition to like 3 to 4 TikToks a day. It was just a lot. And at this point in time, helping to manage Selfless, helping to really build up my team and working on some other really exciting projects, it just was a little bit too much at once. And rather than allowing myself to permit and then just completely cave in, have a breakdown, all this dramatic mess, I figured it'd be better if I just took a short break away from YouTube. And it's allowed me to step back a little bit and kind of look at what's happening across social media, but on YouTube specifically. We are at a really weird time in history. We have been in a pandemic, we're still in a pandemic, but for a lot of people, we have escaped the quarantine experience of having to be at home 24/7 with no stimuli, and consequently turning to social media and our phones as the primary source of stimuli in order order to help us keep our sanity throughout all of this. But now a lot of regions and countries are slowly beginning to open back up and people are returning to some semblance of normality, if you would even call it that. And so because of that, social media progression and content has really come to a slow. Attention isn't as high, views aren't as prevalent, and I primarily attribute that to people being outside, people hanging out with their friends, going to events, public places, all the things that people haven't been able to do for a long time. And because of that, it's only natural that people are just going to be consuming a lot less social media content because we don't have the 10 hours a day that we used to have to just constantly consume so much social media content as our primary source of, well, the closest thing we can find to interaction, really. And as a creator, this can be a really stressful experience. Even though there are many reasons why attention has slowed online, it's easy to look at your own performance and your own views and define yourself and your business through that lens. And now, within this space, it means that more content creators are competing for attention. Not to mention the dramatic shifts in the algorithms that is, quite frankly, affecting everyone, from big creator to small creator. And this entire experience has been really hard on a lot of mental creators' health. I have never before seen so many content creators talking about severe depression, ending up in the hospital, major anxiety, and even trying to take their own life, all within this space of time. And it's really sad to see how the algorithm and the ever-changing interests of the public can affect the mental health of a creator so drastically. And while I do think there are some small changes that can be made in order to better the experience, overall, the internet is a really brutal place. If the algorithm doesn't like you, your videos are not going to be shown to people, regardless of whether they want to watch your videos or not. And when your business, your livelihood, is dependent on online performance, it's only natural that this performance will affect how you perceive yourself and your work. I mean, it makes sense. When views are really high, you're getting a lot of attention, you're like, woo, I feel amazing. But with that moment means you will also experience the opposite when social media attention starts to slow and your business starts to suffer. And when things take a turn like that, it's really easy to be hard on yourself and feel like it's your fault, even when it might not be. And I think this is really important to talk about right now because of how drastically it's affecting so many creators. And personally, I don't feel that this mindset of viewing yourself based off of your online performance is healthy at all. This never-ending pressure to keep innovating, keep creating, keep progressing all the time and never being able to slow down in fear that the public or the algorithm will just not be interested anymore is unsustainable and will eventually lead to burnout. And that's one of the main reasons I took this last month to just kind of take a step back, look at everything that's going on, and really determine where I want my channel to be. Over the past month, I've been reflecting and thinking a lot about what direction I want my channel to go. On one hand, I love making skincare content, and skincare will always be a part of my channel. But on the other hand, repeating the same styles of content over and over and over again because I know it's worked in the past, frankly, isn't true and authentic to the reason why I started my channel in the first place. I wanted my channel to be a resource to help people learn, grow their confidence, and make a positive difference in the world. And I'm really happy to say that I think my channel, in, you know, a small way, has been able to do that. But interestingly enough, when I meet you guys in public, the main thing I hear from people is not gratitude for my skincare videos, but more so the videos where I've talked about my mental health, where I've talked about local issues in Hawaii, where I've shown my Hawaii life, where I've opened up about personal issues, and things just not directly related to skincare. And it's really got me thinking about opening up the type of content I typically create to a broader world beyond skincare and kind of bring you guys into my life and show more behind the scenes and personal struggles and personal victories and talk about other passions and interests I have. Example A, this video. And I know a lot of people are like, no, I love your skincare content, and don't worry, skincare will always be a part of my content. But at the same time, I don't think regurgitating a lot of the same information in just repetitive videos over and over again is true to why I wanted to create content in the first place. I think there's other areas that I can create in, other audiences that I can speak to, and just honestly, it's something I want to do just for personal enjoyment. Now, this type of switch can be really risky in an already dramatically shifting online environment, but this past month has really allowed me to think about why I love being a content creator. Not the attention, not the algorithm, not the viral content, it's the special connection I have with each one of you. And in true relationship format, I would love to bring you guys closer into my life and show you some of the other passions and interests that I have. Talk about important issues, have fun, and show you other aspects of myself beyond skincare. And with that, I would love to hear from you guys what type of content you want to see. Do you want to see my life on a day-to-day basis? Do you want me to talk about mental health and my personal experiences? Do you want more social issue focused videos? Do you want more videos like this? Whatever it may be, I would just love to hear what you guys want to see in order to, you know, have a lot of fun making content and create the best videos possible for you guys. So comment down below any ideas you guys have. Anyway, just had to interrupt with that because it was really heavy on my mind and I'm really glad I got it out. So we will continue on with the video. Social media can be lonely and hard on mental health. And that's why it's important to find other constructive sources of validation to reassure ourselves that we are valid, that we deserve to be happy. And a lot of those sources come outside of social media, not from social media. And like I've said multiple times in this video, this is not a pity party for content creators saying that we have it the most hard out of anyone. But I do want to say it can be really difficult to have elements of your personal life be under constant scrutiny, criticism, and not consensually documented. Processing the opinions of millions will bring down even the most mentally strong of people. And my recommendation would be to treat content creators like you would people in your day-to-day life, with a healthy balance of support and love, criticism, and consent. And I will say this for myself, being online for a few years and being able to experience all of this, this experience of social media has really taught me the importance of building my own mental health and not to rely too heavily on the validation of people online. I've learned that having daily moments of getting away from social media and connecting nature really heals my soul, that separating my personal life from my online life really promotes genuine connections, and that even in this age of hyperconnectivity, it's okay to take a step back, focus on the people you surround yourself with, take moments for yourself, and breathe. Oh, this has been a heavy video. I need a snuggle break. Oh, I feel so much better. And with that, I'm going to end this video, but not before asking you guys to share some of your thoughts below. I know this video is so different from the normal content that I usually post on my channel, but honestly, I've been ready to try out new content styles, to try new things, and this is a conversation that I've been really interested in having. I'm excited to deep dive into a lot more topics, but of course, I want to hear from you guys. If you even liked this in the first place, let me know. I really enjoyed creating it, so I'm still going to create these types of videos, but I would love to hear what you guys think, so make sure you comment down below and share your respectful opinions. At the end of the day, I'm so grateful for my life and for social media and all that it has given to me, and I'm so lucky to be a part of this incredible community of love and support, and I do not wish that it would be any different. I love my life. And I hope for some of you this was a little bit eye-opening. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell so that you can see my videos every single week. And I am gonna head off to a pole dancing class because I got invited and it sounds like fun. See ya!